Talking fishing, nothing but fishing, talking fishing. If it's facts about fishing that you want to know, then tune in, folks, because this is the show. We'll show you all the right bait to use, so sit right back, you got nothing to lose. Doesn't really matter if it's trout or carp, flathead, marlin, or a gummy shark. Listen to the guys and you can't go wrong. They'll be talking about fishing till the cows come home. Talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing.
Welcome everyone to Talking Fishing, a big show coming your way tonight. Catch of the week finally featuring a Victorian Barramundi. How good is that? We're dedicating a fair bit of the show tonight to Hazelwood Barramundi with the Chief of Fisheries joining us on the couch in a minute to answer all your questions. We have got some footage of Trelly that's been sent to us that makes interesting viewing, all that and more. So let's get into it with a big welcome to the man who travels by kayak, Adam Ring. Welcome, Ads.
Thanks, Dave. And I put the kayak away this weekend because unfortunately I didn't get a run for the ballot up at Hazelwood. So you know what? I'm not interested.
Oh, protest vote.
In all seriousness though, what? This is just massive.
Bigger than Ben-Hur.
It's massive for Victorian Fisheries, yeah. And we'll talk more about it later, but well done to everyone involved.
Lots to talk about Hazelwood Barra. It's also a very big welcome to the man from Shepherd and Stephen, Victor Trelfel. Welcome, Trelly.
Thank you very much, Dave. I'm interested about the footage. I reckon you're going to take a bit of yardage out of this.
Things get sent to us. Kramer's mailbag, shall we? Yeah. You're just going to have to wait and see what goes on. But okay. Genuine to me.
But the word is out, even in Shepparton, about Barramundi and Hazelwood. So it's
everybody. I come and joined you in Shepparton for the weekend and the big Murray conference, and it was fantastic.
You can't remember it, though.
And everyone talked about Barra. And our special guest this week is none other than the Head of Fisheries Victoria, Executive Director Travis Dowling. Welcome, Trav.
G'day, Dave. Good to be here.
Mate, good to have you on the couch. Yeah. And we're going to talk about some of the things that you guys have delivered on behalf of the Victorian government. It's just fantastic. The conference was one of them, but the biggest news is the Barramundi, isn't it?
Oh, it's just been amazing. You know, we know that we've got probably 20,000 Victorians who might get the first chance in their life to catch a Barramundi. And a Barramundi in Victoria, it's something that they'll tell their children about. So, you know, we're really excited about it.
If you missed the news, here's the news.
The famous game fish Barramundi is normally found only in the warm waters of Australia's north. But from today, you can catch them in Gippsland. To boost the economy of the struggling area, the Hazelwood Power Station pond has been stocked with thousands of highly prized barra.
Ironically, Victoria's first season opening for an iconic tropical fish was wet, cold and windy.
The very thought of having it in Victoria just is sensational. It's just incredible.
Bites were rare today.
How's that double hook up on Barramundi in Victoria? Yeah, baby.
But in hot conditions on Wednesday, Future Fish Foundation's Dave Kramer caught and released 20 barra in the 26-degree waters of the Hazelwood Power Station pond.
This is just stuff of dreams, isn't it?
These are some of the 7,000 released here last April. Scientists say they're now safe to eat.
These fish are healthy, they're fit, they're fat, and they're as good as any Northern Territory Barramundi.
Until the end of March, 25 boats a day will be allowed onto the pond. 14,000 people have applied.
Oh, it's awesome when they take the lure, jump through the water. Yeah, it's fantastic.
When the power station closes in March, fisheries officers say that will reduce the water temperature here. They don't know, though, exactly what impact that'll have on the fish population. And if Deb finally bags a barra?
Oh, ecstatic. You'll hear the yell from Timbuktu, I think. I think there'll be high fives at everybody. I'm going to run up and down and high five everyone, I think.
Nick McCallum, 7 News.
And I tell you what, for commercial news, to give that a 2-minute story on a Friday night is pretty damn special, boys, isn't it?
Great stuff.
It's not every story that gets 2 minutes, and it was just great to... It's unique. It's massive for fishing in Victoria, isn't it?
It is huge.
It really
is. I reckon we've done more media in a week than just about every other fishery story in 2 years.
Yeah.
So it's just phenomenal how it's captured people's
interest. Amazing. Boys, let's have a look at what's been caught by the people at home. It's time for Catch of the Week.
Catch of the Week, brought to you by Shimano, providing reliable, trustworthy, quality fishing gear for your enjoyment.
Let's kick it off with a non-barramundi, boys, because there's a lot of different species again being caught this week. Let's kick it off with a calamari from Hans Inlet. And I can't quite see his name there. Sychal Peak landed a beautiful calamari, Hans Inlet in Western Port, boys. What a classic fish.
Big fish.
And you know what? Look, I don't know, correct me if I'm wrong, but the big calamari, it's December. Normally they're around August, September, maybe into October, and then you don't see a lot. There's a lot of big calamari around at the moment.
Possibly because of the water temperature? I don't know. But the season's shifted, hasn't it? It has shifted.
Yeah, we're a bit late this
year. We'll take it, though. That's absolutely huge.
Second catch of the week is a classic, and I'll just read from the script here that Michael sent us. He said, we fished out of San Remo on the weekend and caught some cracking whiting to 44 centimetres, but...
Anything to do with Baz on the screen?
Yeah, hang on. My 84-year-old dad, Baz Rushford, came out Sunday afternoon and landed this 6-kilo snapper. Your son Mick sent that in, Baz, and I tell you what, that's a crack. Look at the smile on his face at 84, and he's landing 6-kilo snapper in Western Port. You've got to be pretty happy with that, eh?
Absolutely.
What a great Christmas feed.
And got some 44-centimetre whiting, which I'm being told there's a few around in Western Port, boys. So that's pretty good. Keep you on the snapper scene, but over in Port Phillip Bay is a lovely place called Sandringham, plenty of fish there. And on a Basil. Got a beautiful 6.5-kilo model. Have a look at that, boys.
Six is the new three.
Yeah.
They're all 6 kilos.
Yeah. That's a cracking-looking fish. I mean, that for a December fish is still looking. Look at the blue on the fins and how fresh-looking that is, the big knobby head. Well done, Onay. That's a great cracker of a fish. Yep. Now, a bit of ping-pong tonight. Western Port, Port Phillip, back to Western Port. Mm-hmm. Now, this fish is a classic bycatch, boys. 81 centimetres of flathead by Amanda Keeler.
Wow.
Off French Island. So she doesn't quite want to give away the spot. Somewhere in Western Port.
Fair enough.
I would say on the southern end. But is that a cracker flathead or what?
Fishing for snapper or gullies?
Yeah. I think they're fishing for snapper. Yeah. So they're probably in the deep trav. But do you know your species of flathead well?
Like, yeah.
What is it?
Looks like a
mako, is it? No, but it's not. Obviously, it's not a dusky. You don't get dusky flathead.
It's not a dusty flathead.
It's not dusty.
But is that
it looks very flatheadish.
Is that a rock flathead? Is it a yank? Is it a sand? I don't know.
You said it was by before. You said it was by before. Bycatch.
I wasn't talking about its what it does later. After midnight,
rainbow fin.
This is a first. If we had a drum roll, we'd have a drum roll. But we haven't. Trelly, you want to do a drum roll?
Okay. What are you?
No.
Not yet. Just calm down.
Trelly, this is the first time in world history that a Victorian barramundi is going to feature in Catch of the Week. Alex Zurib, I think you say it. 50 centimetre barramundi from Hazelwood Pontage. How good is it?
50 centimetre Victorian barramundi.
Well done, Alex. Brilliant. The very first person to feature in Catch of the Week with a barramundi from Victoria. How good is that? That's history in the making.
It is.
Absolutely. Let's get onto the freshwater scene because you can't escape what's happening up in the freshwater. And I know this is a little bit undersized, but that doesn't matter because it's a great photo. Bree Malia. I think that's how you say it. A 50 centimetre Murray cod out of Lake Eildon. I mean, any cod is a great cod.
Yep.
And just to get one on the troll out of Lake Eildon is just absolutely fantastic, isn't it?
Great looking fish, aren't they? They come out of clear water up there.
We're going to talk about cod because I went cod fishing with you on Saturday.
Yep.
And got my first ever cod, and I'm happy to say that.
Yeah, and you remember it.
I remember it. But just before we do that, Ben and Mason headed up to the Cod Classic in Lake Marwala, and both of them, Ben got his PB golden perch there, and then Mason got his first ever, which I think went 51 centimetres from memory
They caught yellow belly. They didn't catch cod.
I think they just caught yellow belly.
Someone's got to do it. That's exactly right.
I've got to keep moving. If you'd like to send in a pic of your catch of the week, this is what you have to do.
If you want to be like me and have your photo on TV, email your fishing pic to info@ifish.com.au.
And coming up on Talking Fishing, product of the week, and we take a look at some Hazelwood barramundi being caught right after this.
Talking Fishing.
know what you'd rather be doing.
We know what you've really got in mind.
We know you'd rather be out fishing. And today's the day you're gonna wear the line.
'Cause every day's a good day. Stop wishing. Every day's a chance to drift away.
Drift away.
Every day's a good day for fishing.
Product of the Week, brought to you by Tackle World.
Talking Fishing.
I just couldn't resist, and with Hazelwood Barramundi opening this week, I had to do the top five barra lures for Hazelwood. As per reports, I didn't make them up, as per reports that came out of the first weekend at Hazelwood, I'm going to include Dave in this because he was up there with the iFish crew, catching a few fish and getting it all on film for us all to see. But Jackson DeVitas, I spoke about this a few weeks ago, and I'm pretty sure we added it into the cod and yellow belly market, but Hazelwood's turned it around and said, no, no, throw that away. This is all about barra. The reason these are so good, they dive to about 10 feet, which is where Dave, I'm going to include
that's
you
the
here.
Zone. That's the zone.
That was the zone.
Yeah.
10 feet. You can either cast or troll these. They're a great little profile. This one's got a holographic belly. The one Trelly's holding there, which I'll steal off him so you can see. These are all natural tilapia patterns.
I was just going to say it. So there's two. There's a lot of different fish in Hazelwood. Trust me, from a bait fish point of view, and they're all. I think they're all. I'm not an expert in them, but I think they're all African cichlids, and they're either a really natural looking, which is exactly what you're putting on the screen.
Yep.
Or they're orange and yellow.
I'm getting
there's,
to that.
And I know you'll get to it, but what you just showed then is absolutely superb because they're small. You've got to get down to that 10-foot zone. Although yep. There was fish caught. We caught some in shallower.
Yeah, once
10-foot was the
going.
Zone, I can tell you.
Yep. So in tune with that theme, not only the Jackson DeVitas, but the Strata Dredge also proved to be quite successful. Again, you'll notice with all these lures, they're quite natural. Even these darker ones, some of the ones with holographic bellies, they're all designed to show a wounded, injured fish. These are gold. I'd probably say they're more of a trolling lure. Now, trolling's not something we've spoken about with Hazelwood, but I can tell you it's money in the bank. Dave will put his hand up and say yes, because it's all about finding fish. It's a big system. There's lots of different temperature changes. There's lots of different areas with different terrain to fish. And trolling just gives you the edge to find where those fish are. When you find them, tie on your casting lures and away you go. But Strata Dredge, remember that. Natural colours represent the local population of bait fish. They will get the job done when you're not sure where to go. Jackson, again, we spoke about it a few weeks ago, but these lures just prove to be fish catching machines. The gold one, Dave again got these on. These were a casting lure of his. Gold got the job done. He said there is orange and pink fish in there. This represents it beautifully. They holograph and stand out in dark, murky water. The water at the moment is quite discoloured. We've had a lot of rain over winter, a lot of runoff coming into the system. It starts to discolour the water and those golds really stand out. I've also got a green and silver. Again, it's just keeping in tune with the natural selection of bait fish these barra have got to choose from. So Jackson Athlete, remember that. They're a brilliant casting lure. Can troll if need be, but casting's where it's at for these things. Dave, you're holding the exact lure. It's even got the markings to say so.
It's got the barra scars on it, Ads, and that's the one I caught it on, and it's still got the bit of leader on there. And the only reason I cut it off and changed lure is because I think I got four from four casts on this one, but Worsling got six from six casts, and I cracked it with him.
We won't tell anyone.
And I changed lures. Yeah. That was an absolute cracker, I can tell
slow
you.
Slow roll, Dave?
Really slow. You've got to really tweak it hard on that first tweak to get it down low. Whack and then it. Very slow roll that. Yep.
These are a lure which I think are going to feature very heavily. Once the system starts being fished a little bit, we get to know the terrain, we know where the rock walls, the weed edges are. These lures are going to come into their own. Those two patterns you see on the screen, which I'm holding in my hand, are dead set ringers for some of the bait fish in there. These are very easily worked. They work from the bottom up. Rock walls, weed edges, drop-offs. Once we find out where these schools of fish are holding, these lures are going to be absolute machines because you can very slowly roll them through the school of fish. Very good when the fish are shut down, because you can work them subtly, slowly, and really hold them in that strike zone to get the fish to take. So fuse pulse, remember that. It's going to become a staple of Hazelwood Barramundi.
Great hardware on those two ads.
Barra ready?
Yep,
barra ready. Barra ready. These are something else. And I had to show these because the red devils in Hazelwood at the moment look exactly like this. Exactly like this. This one's rigged weedless. And it's an absolute necessity, even without the heavy structure and the heavy growth which we associate with rigging weedless. They work better when they're rigged like this. The weight is all towards the chin of the lure. Very slow roll, get that tail thumping, and a barramundi can't resist it. Again, it's going to come into its own when those fish are being real sulky, sulking on the bottom of the rock walls, the weed edges, the channels. These soft plastic lures are going to be where it's at. Very slow roll. Two different sizes to help match the hatch, but rig them weedless, slow roll, they're going to catch a barramundi. Boys, I couldn't resist. It's so exciting, and I had to get these lures out.
Don't even catch a Richie Minnow, that one.
That's it.
There you go. Now, in a minute, we're going to show a bit of footage that Paul and I filmed last Wednesday. We filmed an episode of iFish TV last Wednesday just to show people how good it was. But pretty good stuff, eh?
Yeah, that's right. And now, where's my camera at? I need to say a few words. On Saturday, Tackle World Mornington, where I work full time, I witnessed something which I haven't witnessed in 10 years of working in this industry. And some congratulations need to be sent out. Hazelwood Barramundi, there's been a lot of talk, there's been a lot of criticism. And unfortunately, we live in a day and age where negativity takes over our lives. I'm here to change that. All those haters, all those people that are on social media because they're too scared to show their faces, that are knocking the people that brought this into play. We've been knocked back with news that this could all be over by the middle of next year. Enjoy it. The excitement around the tackle shops. I can only speak for our own because that's where I was, but I'm sure it was spread right throughout the state. The excitement with fishers. We're selling barramundi lures like you've never seen, and that's through to one thing. That's excitement. So I extend my hand to you, David Kramer, because I know you've put a lot of time a lot of effort, and this is huge for Victorian fishing. And Travis Dowling,
thank you.
Mate, I have to, because it wouldn't be right. For all those haters and keyboard warriors that want to sit behind a computer screen and say things that are negative, walk into any tackle store in Victoria over the next few weekends and witness the excitement. That is what Victorian fishing is all about. And it doesn't matter for once about your opinion, because this is just insane. If you can promote Victorian fishing and fishing in general by adding a new species and a new place, regardless of its longevity, it's only a good thing, because that in turn is what's going to lead to 1 million recreational fishers in Victoria, which the Victorian government is working towards. It's a brilliant initiative, and these guys especially need to be recognised for their hard work, because it's not easy. It takes up a lot of time, and I'd like to say, from one tackle store, and that's just the one I manage, it was a huge, huge success. So well done.
There you go, Ads. Thank you.
Because it is a great fit. Yeah, it is brilliant.
Well said, Ads. And we're going to talk about the popularity with you, Trav, very, very shortly. But I'll tell you what, when I hooked up the first barramundi last Wednesday, I shed a tear, I can tell you. This is what happened last Wednesday.
Barramundi. Barramundi. Barramundi.
Now, David, even though we went to the council offices 10 years ago and put this proposal forward, when did you actually think it might happen?
Well, probably 7 years ago, we actually decided to do something about it, Paul, the Future Fish Foundation, and I was heading it up at the time, and we thought we needed to do a bit of work with the state government and the power station. We picked the state government work first, and we went and did a whole lot of science to prove, I guess scientifically, that barramundi would survive in Hazelwood pondage. That was a pretty big project. We employed Dr. Paul Hardy-Smith. He was absolutely fantastic with the work he did, and it proved that barramundi would survive if released into here. We then went to the state government and lobbied virtually to say, hey, we want you guys to support this project, put some funding in and get it to happen.
So how many barramundi have gone into lakes so far?
Yeah, all up 7,000 fish, Paul. 7,000 fish, and there's no reason why any single one of them wouldn't have survived.
So when was the first big drop of fish?
Well, the big drop was about 5,000 fish midway through 2016. It was a mixture of fish, mixture of finglings, about 10 centimetre fish and 30 centimetre fish. And those 30 centimetre fish are the ones that the mums, the dads, the families that come to fish at Hazelwood Pondage are going to enjoy as big barramundi in Victoria.
Now we're in trouble, David.
Hello,
your mission, should you accept it, is to get this barramundi through all these lines.
I've got him in close.
Hang on. Oh, yeah, I'm on.
You're on.
Oh, this feels, they all feel better, but
yeah.
Maybe we need to stop moving forward. How's that double hook up on barramundi in Victoria? Yeah, baby.
That is good.
It's not good. It's amazing. It's amazing. Oh, he's a jumper. That's our first jumper, David. Isn't this so incredible? We're like little boys. Little boys just having a ball. Oh, yeah, baby. We have jumpage.
I reckon mine's 1 centimetre bigger than yours. I can already tell.
I'm just going to try and grab this.
Victorian barramundi, you beauty.
Look at that. What do you reckon, David? A pigeon pair?
Yeah.
Absolutely. Oh, I reckon they come out of the same mould. Look at those two fish. And did you ever in your wildest dreams, growing up in the beautiful state of Victoria, think that this day could happen?
I didn't think 10 years ago when we presented to council and said we want to put barramundi in, that that would ever come true. So, you know, this is just stuff of dreams, isn't it?
It is stuff of dreams. Now, we're catching the little ones. We believe there's fish in here to nearly 85 centimetres.
Yeah.
Imagine 85 centimetre barramundi that are this fat, and it's not going to be long until we've got 1 metre barramundi here. That's the holy grail.
Well, if these have grown from 30 centimetres to this in 12 weeks, imagine the fish that were put in at 50 centimetres, what they are now. And we're going to try and find them.
We're going to find them, all right. At the moment, we've got barramundi gold. It's going off left, right and centre.
And all I can say is, wow, if you want to see all that and a lot more, tune into iFish TV this Sunday at 5:30 on 1HD because you'll see a whole episode. And boys,
it's something else.
It was special, I can tell you.
It's something else.
Trav, I felt privileged, sure. And thank you very much. And we did fish under a permit that was rather strict. We had to be escorted by fisheries officers. Yep. We didn't take a fish and we weren't allowed to, and we stuck by those rules. And we just wanted to promote it to the rest of Australia, because everybody in Australia, from Northern Territory, WA, Queensland, they're going to see that.
Sure.
We're in a boat.
Yeah.
How many people applied for the ballot?
Well, we've had 15,000 so far apply for the ballot, which is extraordinary. Like, and all credit to you, Dave, and everyone who's absolutely withstood the doubters and the people that said, you know, we can't ever do this. And one of the great things that we try and employ now in fisheries is that there are no boundaries, that we will continue to try and make fishing better in Victoria. And so seeing something like barramundi in Hazelwood and the success of it, and for people to stare down all the critics and that, it's just been brilliant. And when I was there, Dave, I'll just say one thing. I just walked up to two young blokes who I'm not sure they'd ever get the opportunity to go to Northern Territory of Queensland. And these two guys, they were sitting there saying they'd bought the lures, they were down there fishing. They couldn't believe they were getting a chance to catch a barramundi in Victoria. You know, and I just thought, you know, this is what it's all about. It was fantastic.
It's a pretty special thing. Up next, fisheries news and plenty more talking barramundi. Next on Talking Fishing.
Talking Fishing.
Good morning, spotters. Stephanie speaking.
Talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing.
Live from the studios of Channel 31 Melbourne, it's now time for some very fishy news.
plenty of news, and I'm going to get stuck straight into it. It is the season to remember yabby fishing rules is the headline, and it says here, if you're planning on catching a feed of yabbies for Christmas lunch or your summer barbie, Fisheries Victoria is reminding you, catch limits and equipment restrictions apply when fishing for the tasty freshwater crustaceans. Senior Fisheries Officer Jason Peters said daily yabby catch limits applied to all Victorian waterways and reminded anglers there are severe penalties for unlicensed activity, exceeding daily catch limits and using banned equipment, with penalties ranging from $1,550 to $15,500. And Trav, people got to remember, you need a fishing license to go and get yabbies, just the simple yabby, don't you?
Yeah, absolutely. It's like any other fishery. Go and get a fishing license, all the money goes back into better fishing in Victoria.
Yep, there you go. The daily catch limit, just a reminder, limit of yabbies in, on or next to Victorian inland waters is 20 litres of whole yabbies, comprised of no more than 150 individuals, or 5 litres of yabby meat not exceeding 150 tails. Mr. Peter said anglers must not possess more than 60 litres of whole yabbies, or more than 400 individual yabbies, or more than 10 litres of yabby meat not exceeding 400 tails anywhere in Victoria. We'll put all this up on Facebook tomorrow so you can read it again. Recreational anglers are reminded equipment restrictions also apply to the harvest of yabbies, including limits on the type and number of nets that can be used in certain waters. Do you yabby much, Trelly?
Yeah, I do actually. Yeah.
We're talking about on the weekend.
Just a little secret, they're going in the Barma forest.
Oh yeah, there you go.
And around Mathaya.
It went on to say, all nets must have a tag attached on which it is clearly written the user's full name and address, and this must remain above the water surface when the net is set. And we also are reminding anglers the use and possession of yabby pots, including Opera House style nets, is prohibited in, on or next to Victorian public waters. Mr. Peter said a recreational fishing license is required if you're fishing for yabbies or you use or possess recreational fishing equipment in, on or next to Victorian waters, unless you're exempt. So there you go, that's yabbies. Let's keep moving on. A new report, Trav, says Victorian fisheries are in good shape.
Yeah.
You guys must be doing a good job. The Victorian Fish Stock Status Report has been released online and indicates the majority of the state's wild fish stocks are in good shape, which is excellent news for recreational and commercial fishers and seafood consumers. Fisheries Victoria Executive Director, who's sitting here now, Travis Dowling, said the report provides a clear overview of how the state's distinct populations of fish breeds are managed and applies a rating based on the best information currently available to simplify its findings. The report uses a traffic light rating system of green, amber or red to indicate the relative health of each stock. That's not a bad thing. So where can people find this?
It's up on the Fisheries Victoria website. Yep. It's a great reflection on the support that we've got from both recreational fishers and commercial fishers to make sure that the fisheries we've got now are going to be great fisheries in the future. And I have to say, you know, things are looking really bright for fishing in Victoria, whether you're a rec fisherman or a commercial fisherman. Our stocks, you know, the way that they're recovering at the moment, it's all looking good.
Went on to say, of the 27 key Victorian managed fisheries rated in the report, 17 were classified as green, 10 were amber, and pleasingly, none of them were red. I'll finish that one there. Let's move on. This one, calamari catch limit is exceeded at Queenscliff Pier. You been down Queenscliff Pier, Trelly? No? I was just wondering, you got tackle world in Geelong there. A sunshine man, it's not you then. You're from Shepparton. Sunshine Man was apprehended by Fisheries Victoria officers on the Queenscliff Pier early on the morning of December 8 after allegedly taking more than the daily catch limit of calamari. What a goose. Fisheries Victoria officer Mark Gibson said the man was observed by officers around 6 a.m. placing 15 squid in his car boot. That's a silly thing to do. And later seen returning to the car at 7 a.m. with another 15.
Yeah.
On searching the vehicle, we found additional squid, making a total of 30 calamari, and the daily limit is 10. What an idiot. Why would you? Like, seriously?
Yeah. It's just one of those things where fishermen think that, there's a really hot bite, I'm really tempted to do it. Yeah. And our advice to them is just don't do it. It's just not worth it.
Queenscliff, yeah. Now, they're going off in Queenscliff.
Yeah, I was going to say, Queenscliff.
On this occasion, the squid was seized by officers along with 4 fishing rods and tackle. So, lost that. It's good for your shop in Geelong because you'll probably go and buy some more. And he'll be required to face the Geelong Magistrates Court. And there you go. It goes on a bit about that one. We've got to keep moving along. More bass stocking for Gippsland anglers. Freshwater fishing opportunities for wreck anglers in Gippsland are set to improve further following the release of 122,000 Australian bass fingerlings last week. Does someone actually count them, Trev?
Yeah, we've got a person who counts everyone, but we're also putting an extra 40,000 on top of that into the Snowy River. So all of those waters that we've covered, like what we're seeing now is a bass rollout across Gippsland that hasn't happened ever before. It's the first time ever. And there's, if you like fishing for bass, you're going to be able to catch them. It's going to be great.
There you go. Since 2002, more than 800, I'm flying through these. Kevin can hardly keep his finger on the button. We're going that fast. Since 2002, more than 800,000 bass fingerlings have been stocked throughout Gippsland, and feedback from anglers suggests they are doing very well. Have a look at some of the waters that have been stocked. I think we've got a slide on that as well. Coming up, there you go, Avon River 5,000, Blue Rock 25,000, and you can see the rest there. Taralgon Creek 2,000, Tyres River 5,000, Thompson's River 5,000, Tambo River 20,000, sorry. That's fantastic.
And it's your recreational fishing license fees that are paying for that. That's fantastic.
Let's keep punching through them. I've got to say, can I show off for a sec?
In eight days
I cracked a pretty special trifecta, and I'm pretty proud of it, and I just wanted to show you people at home. I think Saturday before last, a beautiful calamari off Queenscliff, and I was pretty proud of that. Probably doesn't do it justice.
Fair, no, that's all right.
Yeah, does it? Yeah, it's, that's up there with my PB.
Yep.
A little
fair
bit
colour.
Four days later,
big thumbs.
Barramundi and Hazelwood. Yeah, we're going to click to that one, Barramundi and Hazelwood, and that was the biggest of the day.
Nice.
Is it the Quinella they call it there? And have a look at this for a trifecta. I fished with you, Trelly, for a lovely Murray cod.
That's a beautiful fish.
Walking the banks of the Broken Creek.
Look at that.
Correct.
After a big night with
Trelly.
A
little bit hungover.
and on the Codulure.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for the trifecta, Trelly. Really appreciate it.
The big three.
Yeah.
I was walking the bank, because it was illegal to drive at that point.
Yeah. You can hardly walk.
Guess what, boys? It's no time to talk Barra again.
Yeah.
Up next, Kramer's Mailbag, including some never seen before footage of a young Trelly. Next on Talking Fishing.
Talking Fishing.
G'day, David Kramer here. I'm a massive fan of the Mazda BT50, having personally driven and owned one for more than 5 years now. And to tell you what, you can't beat it for an all-round great ute and a great tow vehicle. Get into Mornington Mazda before the end of the month and grab yourself a run-out bargain. I made mine a Mornington Mazda.
Make mine a Mornington Mazda.
Talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing.
Hard to control the crowd tonight, I can tell you. Anyway, let's get into mailbag. And Travis from Euroa has sent us in a...
Relax.
This is fair income. Travis from Euroa has sent in a video. I don't know if he knows you, Charlie. This was taken back in the days of VHS. Right? Let's just have a look. This is you when you were young.
Jeez!
Yeah. I didn't know you had a blow up boat, Trelly.
That's last week.
That wasn't me.
Oh, what?
Time for the kids to go to bed.
You idiot.
Now, I know we had no audio in here, Trelly, but you do recall yelling out some things.
I think it was.
Was that really you?
It was. Travis from Euroa, it says he. Sorry, just a bit of breaking news too before we go to the next mailbag. Channel 31, we've got a lifeline.
Stop it!
Newsflash, just come on. We'll see you in 2017. Community TV stations have received a 6-month extension to free to air broadcast. That is massive news.
That's great. Great stuff.
We've still got a job.
I was going to the Bahamas for 6 months. Now I'll stay around Melbourne. Anyway, I've got to work for a living again. So we will be back in 2017. Don't worry about
that. And live, not the average repeat just out of summer.
All right, let's get on to it. This is from Mel. This is about Channel 31. Mel wrote, hi, sorry to be sending you a complaint again. I don't remember your first one, Mel, but anyway. But I love your show. The only thing is the sound. It has to be the worst out there. I still don't know where you went prawning, as every time you mention it, you all broke up. And the only one example from tonight's show. I live in Glen Iris, and this has been happening for a long time, and wonder if I'm the only one to let you know, from Mel. Yeah, well, Mel, you are the only one.
Where's Glen Iris? Mel, first of all, late tires.
Oh, yeah, well, I wrote back on email. I did the
second,
right thing. Second,
Craig, I know you're listening to me, mate, but lift your
sound,
game.
Man.
lift your game, pal.
Does anyone know where Glen Iris is? Is it on
Melbourne?
Glen Iris.
Oh, well, I should be going to there.
Let's do it that way.
All right, well, there you go.
Leafy suburbs.
Richard writes into us, I agree with Trelly. Regarding golden perch limits, 10 each is too much. And yes, freezing them and keeping them too long does give freezer burn and don't taste so good. Like everything in life, there has to be a balance for a long-term future, not just for greedy individuals. Thanks. So did you say that at some stage, Trelly?
Oh, I must have, because he agreed with me.
Must have fallen asleep in that
bag bit. Limit on yellow belly should be dropped, Travis. I don't want to put you in the deep end, but what do you reckon? You're a freshwater man.
Well, we're stocking a lot of fish at the moment, and we're heading towards 5 million fish, and a lot of people are catching golden perch.
Yeah.
We've already gone from 10 to 5 in Lake Eildon. I reckon let's just see how it goes for a while, and we've got good catches at the moment, and we want people to go out there and enjoy it.
I guess the only thing is, you talk about the social side of things. If the anglers were to drive that and go, what's socially responsible to take? And 10 golden perch that big's probably too much. But anyway, that's, I guess, for the anglers.
That wouldn't be a bad survey to run. You're saying what's socially acceptable. Obviously, a lot of what fisheries do in their size and bay, as Trevor's all science-based, but it would be great to see what the people think from a social acceptance point of view.
You must have a fair database, Trevor, of people that buy online licences and give their emails now.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
have you thought about surveying them?
No, we're going to do that. Yeah. We're going to do a wreck fishing survey as part of Tago. But we really do take into consideration what we consider as a reasonable day's take.
Yeah.
And we like to think that we're in pretty good touch with the people that fish and what they consider is a fair enough take. And we don't want people filling up freezers for 3 months. No. Take a fresh feed home, but you don't need to feed the whole neighbourhood and have, fish, going bad in your freezer. Mm. We've dropped the bag limit on golden perch in a number of different places. And, it's great now at the moment. We're getting lots of support coming back from, people saying, I'm getting, 5 golden perch. They're, they're 3 to 4 pound each. That's more than enough for me for the day.
Yeah.
The thing is, Trevor, you've seen, you witnessed, and you know very well what's happening at Eildon.
Yeah.
With golden perch. Yeah. I mean, that's brought it to the light, hasn't it?
Yeah, no, absolutely.
People catching, from an ethnic variety of those people that, pass them on to Melbourne and sell them off, so.
Well, what we're seeing is that when the golden perch come on, they bite really hard.
Yeah.
And if you're there and you're able to catch them, you can really do a lot of, I suppose, significant. You can change the population pretty quickly. And we're saying, let's not, in 1 month, knock out 2 or 3 years of really good fish stocking.
Yeah.
Let's let it be there forever. And
it's against the spirit of what's been put in.
And
that's it.
All right, got to keep moving along. Trav, the next one, I haven't got the photo, sorry to show the people at home, but there's a photo of Hazelwood Pondage car park on Sunday afternoon with, hasn't got 25 cars in it. And Doug is saying that, the ballot, there seems to be a few people that aren't going, even though they've won the ballot. Is there anything that fisheries can do about that? And I don't want to put you on the spot with that one.
We've been asked this in the shop too.
Yeah, plenty of people talking about it.
And there's been a lot of social media on this, and I empathise and understand people want to go and fish this place, and we want them to go and fish there. And me as, and my team, and I have to give full credit to Anthony Forster and Taylor Hunt and John Douglas, the staff of mine that have worked really hard on doing it. And I'll just let all of your listeners and viewers know, Dave, that we will do everything we can to get as many people fishing Hazelwood as possible.
Yep.
And if we have to tweak or change some of the arrangements we've got in place, we're absolutely open to looking at that, because our whole aim is to get people to the valley to catch a barramundi, and we'll continually review how things are working to make sure we make that happen.
One bloke that fished it yesterday was Will Minson, ex-Bulldogs, and I said I wouldn't take his call unless he promised he would never think about going to Collingwood again. And he didn't catch a fish. And I think some of the people that have been in the ballot, and his mate was successfully went along, and they didn't catch a fish. Yeah. What that does is it sent him home going, okay, I've got to change tactics.
Yeah.
And I've got to buy this lure, and I've got to do this next time.
But then
they haven't got a chance, and they want to go back. So anyway, Trav, Christmas Day. How was the ballot for Christmas Day?
Well, it's... fully loaded.
Oh, is it?
Mm. Yeah,
okay. Absolutely. I had someone ring up today asking about Christmas Day. Is there any spots left on Christmas
Day?
No, it's
fully loaded. I actually...
What a way to spend Christmas Day.
Yeah, yeah, catching a Victorian
bag. It was Travis Dowling, Stephen Dowling, Graham Dowling, Lucy Dowling.
Lily Dowling, Atticus Dowling, Jackson Dowling. No, I'll just say, Dave, we and it's a random draw, but we had three people from the same family who all landed on a Christmas Day, and they're making a day of it, and they're absolutely chuffed with it.
Wow.
They're going to do their Christmas morning presents and all the rest of it, and then spend the afternoon...
And roast Barramundi.
Fishing for Barramundi.
Roast turkey for bait.
Yeah. No, they're over the... No complaints. They're loving it.
Can I ask the big question?
Sure.
And I've got a few questions here. Why is it necessary to limit boat-based recreational fishing at Hazelwood Pondage?
So we've got a car park area, and we have to work with a range of different groups, and we work with Latrobe City Council, and we work with Engie, the power company that's there. And you know, to achieve what we've been able to achieve, we've had to really make sure that everyone's on board with what we do. Now, not everyone will agree with it, and some people would like to park up on the road and park in a paddock and all the rest of it, but we want to make this fishery work. And so the car park, as it currently stands, doesn't have much beyond a 25 boat and car capacity. And so we're really trying to work to that and give everyone as much of a chance as possible. I would say, though, if you are one of those 25 and you are lucky enough to get out there, you know, you don't have to be casting across 18 different people and have 48 boats trolling behind you. If you're one of the 25 boats that are going to be on there for the day, you're going to have a good experience.
Fair enough. Yeah. And the people that are in the boat, now only one of those people need a permit, don't they?
That's right.
Yep.
So basically, if you've got a 3.9 metre staser or if you've got a larger boat, and it depends on what your boat is legally allowed to carry, and you can put as many people as legally allowed to carry in the boat.
What checks are in place to ensure permits are not transferred?
Yeah, so look, our fisheries officers are going around, they're having a chat to people, and all credit to Errol Parmesan and the team down at Traralgon and Yarram and others that are working through making sure that Hazelwood works. And I will say to people, our fisheries officers are trying to make this work, and they're going to work with you to try and make this work. We're not taking a heavy stick approach, but please just try and do the right thing and make sure this fishery is of great success going forward.
Sorry, I didn't end mailbag. So if you'd like to write into Kramer's mailbag, this is what you have to do.
Send your mail to Kramer's Mailbag, P.O. Box 734, Paterson Lakes, Victoria 3197, or email kramer@ifish.com.au.
Now, coming up this week's hotspots, we're going to talk more about Barramundi and Hazelwood next on Talking Fishing.
Talking Fishing.
G'day, Callan here from Paul Worsland's Tackle World Cranbourne.
Supercharged batteries have been supplying maintenance-free marine batteries since 2001. The Seamaster Gold range is second to none, delivering superior starting power and reserve capacity. No need to top up with water, truly a fit and forget battery. With up to 2 years replacement warranty, you know you have quality. Your battery is your lifeline. Without it, you're dead in the water, because it's bloody hard to push start.
I've got a Seamaster battery in my boat.
Make yours a Seamaster Gold today.
Talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing.
Hello, Richie Minnow here. It's now time for this week's fishing hotspots on Talking Fishing. Marvellous.
Oh dear, Richie's been at it again. Hasn't been wearing a condom, but anyway. Yeah, well, they've got babies now.
Yeah. They might have been playing today.
Richie and
someone
Kylie.
Stuck it with a pin.
Oh dear. Let's hit straight into the hotspots. And number one, King George Whiting, capital of the western side of Port Phillip Bay, into Corio Bay, is Clifton Springs Trelly, straight out of your Geelong report. And I saw some cracker photos coming out of Clifton Springs.
Yeah, it's incredible, and we talked about this earlier tonight, Trav, about that whole area has been fishing so well since we've had the restrictions on netting in that area. It's just incredible. Yeah. So it's really good.
Only going to get better. Is it one more year of, and then it's totally out of Corio Bay, Trav?
Yeah, April 2018.
Yeah.
First of April 2018.
Right smack bang in the middle of Port Phillip Bay is a lovely place called the Pinnace Channel. It's a great place for King George Whiting. It's just to the north of Mud Island, and it's one of my favourite spots, boys. Over the size of the MCG of weed beds that are just chock a block full of King George Whiting at the moment, get there to the Pinnace Channel. Let's head over to Western Port, and the capital if you like, is the middle spit. The middle spit. You can't go wrong.
Nah.
A few people spotted charter boats sitting on the top end of the middle spit during the week, and they are absolutely creaming.
Yeah. Question without notice. King George whiting.
Yep.
Potentially the best whiting season we've ever seen.
I reckon it
early
is.
Early stages?
Yeah. Trav, I know Greg Jenkins predicted, Paul Hamer, all their work said it was good.
Yeah.
But I really think that already in Port Phillip, the reduction in netting is letting these schools of fish stay in the one area.
Yeah.
They're certainly fatter than I've ever seen before. And the numbers are fantastic.
Well, what's surprising us is how early they're turning up. Yeah, we're meant to
Well, they didn't go away all year.
Yeah.
They just didn't go away, Trav.
But people are still meant to be, you know, really going for snapper, and the snapper fishing is going incredibly well at the moment as well. And put, you know, it's hard for people to decide where to go.
Yeah.
Snapper
and
or whiting.
And that's a great point you make, because not once did we say an editor is wiping out a whole school, but they disperse the school. They move them on.
Yeah.
But now they're staying in one spot.
Or that place didn't repopulate for a couple of weeks after they were taken. So another great place, if you want to get a big one, the place to go is San Remo, down near Phillip Island there. There are some cracker fish. Reports of 42 to 44 centimetres in length for King George whiting. And that's a good whiting in anyone's books, isn't it, boys? Yeah.
Fast-moving, crystal clear water down there.
Let's head up into the freshwater scene. And Trelly, you took me for a tour around Shepparton. We saw some anglers on the banks of the Goulburn River, right in the middle of town, catching Murray cod. And how good is that?
It's been a really good trip. And you know, that whole area there has been fishing well for quite, since the opening. It's just bang on.
I heard last week one of the hotspots was Murchison, and apparently anglers reported that anglers have been hitting it pretty hard the last few weeks before then. So on bait, apparently they can't catch them on lures, but anyway.
And just before the show, producer Kev, whereabouts is Shepparton in Vic? Did you just throw a dart at it? Or?
It was late last night. I'd had a long day yesterday.
It was late Friday night when he put that one in there.
And I might have put the wrong pin
the dart
on
at it.
In Shepparton.
I think he put the pin in the top of his shoe Friday night and went home with it.
We didn't go to bed Friday night, Kelly, remember? We went to bed Saturday morning.
That's right.
And lucky last, a great place, a recreational fishing haven it is, Lake Tyres. And Trav, we're just recommending to people get there before the Christmas crowd. Because it's going to be packed, and there's going to be so many flathead come out of there soon.
Well, Dave, can I say a very good friend of mine, Jeff Fraser, will be watching this show tonight.
Yeah.
And the fact that you've said that, I'm going to get text messages after the show. Go, tell him to stop talking about it.
We're talking about big prawns. What were you talking about?
No, it's just prawns. There's no other fish in Lake Tyres. It's only prawns.
In all honesty, and I know we want to get back onto Barramundi, but any reports of the mulloway that you have stocked into Lake Tyres?
Yeah, we actually haven't found any yet in there, and that's they are called the ghosts of estuaries, because even though they can be there, they're very hard to track down. We're very optimistic that they're still in there, but we've been doing work to try and find them, and I'm yet to see a photo from an angler with an actual confirmed.
How long ago were they stopped?
About a year ago,
and they were only little,
yeah they were small, but they should be sort of 30 to 40 centimeters now,
so catchable.
So people should be picking them up on plastics and vibes and different things like that.
Did you tag any?
Well, I know that there was that, what do you call it, there's a we do something with the otoliths, the chemical barrier marking of the of the otoliths, so that we will know when we pull one out, when we pull the ear bone out of the fish, whether or not it's one of our stock fish. We're always continually try to improve these fisheries.
And some of it is experiments and testing.
And they're mulloway. They might pop up in 5 years' time, maybe 15 kilos, and just go on the chew.
I'm just waiting this summer for the photo to come through going, hey, I just caught this thing. It looks like a mulloway. I'm in the Now and Our Armour Lake Tyres.
This is the coolest mullet I've ever seen.
There'll be high fives around the office.
We might need an open season on pelicans down there.
Let's go back to the Barramundi, and a question, Trav, I've got is, if you don't have a permit and you're out on the boat, you're just going to launch and go for Barra, what's the penalty?
Well, significant is my answer. I don't want to scare people to death, but I'm just saying, our fisheries officers are taking a really responsible approach with people, and where people are straying into areas they shouldn't or doing things they shouldn't, we're really trying to encourage people. Again, like I said earlier, Just don't wreck it for everyone. Do the right thing. Stay within the rules. Everyone's going to get their chance.
Yep.
It's going to hopefully be a good fishery for a while.
So people might be smart and go, well, I can't find the law that says anything about barramundi because there hasn't been any. Yeah. You've introduced this through a fisheries notice.
Without getting too technical, I've got the power as executive director under delegation from the minister to issue a fisheries notice, which has the same legal capacity as regulation or, you know, basically legislation. Yep. And we do that, we can do it within 24 hours notice, it's gazetted. And, you know, people can find these notices, they're out there. But, you know, we do this for a range of fisheries, whether it's a slot size for dusky flathead, whether it's, you know, a bag limit on golden perch, we'll put them in place until we change the legislation. But they have those same powers. We do enforce them and people are prosecuted regularly under them. But just do the right thing and really enjoy a great fishery out there.
Yep. All right, tell us about what's the bag limit, the possession limit and edibility of these fish.
So we've basically gone with, we want everyone to have the chance to take a barra home because I always defend everyone's right to take a fish home. We've done a lot of, so it's one fish and there's no size limit on it. So if you get a 75 centimetre one or you get a 40 centimetre one, you can take it home if you want. They are a stocked fishery. And we've done a lot of testing on the flesh quality, and it's pretty good. Like it's actually right up there with a number of our other waterways. So we're recommending no more than 3 servers of barra a week, but certainly they're safe to eat.
Trelly normally has about 10, but anyway, he'll restrict himself. Can you use live fish for bait in Hazelwood pondage?
No, because what we don't want to see is some of the invasive species that have been dropped in there. And it's like every child that's got a tropical invasive species for Christmas, fish for Christmas, has gone and dropped it into Hazelwood. So we've got 14 or 15 different invasive species in there. We don't want those to get into the Murray-Darling Basin system or anywhere else. So we don't want people taking them out and, you know, using them live. You can use dead fish, and I've seen, when I was down there last week, I saw people using dead tilapia and dead other species to use for bait.
But not live.
Mm. Not live.
Yep.
Yeah.
Like Trav, we're going to run out of time.
Sure.
I just want to say thank you for coming on tonight. And
I know it's hard
to get your time. I know you've been busy because there's been a lot happening, but really, really appreciate any time that you give to Talking Fishing. Thank you very much.
Thank you, and thanks to the boys. It's been a fantastic year, and you know, we really appreciate the great support we've had from you and all the Victorian fishermen.
There you go. That's it for Talking Fishing. We hope you enjoyed the show. Next week is our last live show for the year, but we're not going anywhere with news this week that C31 will continue into 2017. Next week is a much-watched show. Plenty of special things planned until we see you again next Tuesday on Talking Fishing. Please stay safe on the water and enjoy your fishing.
Talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing.
We got all you need, just take a look. Watch those fish jump on your hook. So just relax and take your time. Enjoy the show, then drop us a line.
Talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing. Talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing.
Talking fishing.
Have a good weekend, Mr. Walker.
You too, son.